Absolute bodily coincidence, long and absent, stately, Was it my own excited imagination, or the misty influence of the atmosphere, or the uncertain twilight of the chamber, or the gray draperies which fell around her figure that caused it so vacillating and distinct in outline? I could not tell. She spoke no word. I, not for worlds, could I have uttered a syllable. An icy chill ran through my frame. A sense of insufferable anxiety oppressed me. A consuming curiosity pervaded my soul. And sinking back upon the chair, I remained for some time breathless and motionless, with my eyes riveted upon her person. Alas, its emaciation was excessive, and not one vestige of the former being lurked in any single line of the contour. My burning glances at length fell upon the face. My forehead was high and very pale and singularly placid, and the once jetty hair fell partially over it and overshadowed the hollow temples with innumerable ringlets, now of a vivid yellow and jarring discordantly in their fantastic character, with the reigning melancholy of the countenance. My eyes were lifeless and lustreless and seemingly pupilless, and I shrank involuntarily from their glassy stare to the contemplation of the thin and shrunken lips. They parted it in a smile of peculiar meaning. The teeth of the changed Berenice disclosed themselves slowly to my view. Would to God that I had never beheld them, or that, having done so, I had died. The shutting of a door disturbed me, and looking up, I found that my cousin had departed from the chamber. But from the disordered chamber of my brain had not, alas, departed, and would not be driven away. White and ghastly spectrum of the teeth, not a speck on their surface, not a shade on their enamel, not an indenture in their edges, but what that period of her smile had sufficed to brand in upon my memory. I saw them now even more unevocably than I beheld them then. The teeth, they were here and there and everywhere, invisibly and palpably before me. Long and narrow and excessively white, with the pale lips writhing about them, as in the very moment of their first terrible development. Then came the full fury of my monomania, and I struggled in vain against its strange and irresistible influence. In the multiplied objects of the external world, I had no thoughts but for the teeth. For these I longed with a frenzied desire. All other matters and all different interests became absorbed in their single contemplation. They alone were present to the mental eye, and they, in their sole individuality, became the essence of my mental life. I held them in every light, I turned them in every attitude. I surveyed their characteristics, I dwelt upon their peculiarities. I pondered upon their conformation. I mused upon the alteration in their nature. I shuddered as I assigned to them, in imagination, a sensitive and sentient power. And even when unassisted by the lips, a capability of moral expression. Of Mad Sale, it was been said, and of Bernice I more seriously believed. Here was the idiotic thought that destroyed me. Therefore, it was that I coveted them so madly. I felt that their possession could alone
the box that lay
force it open, and in my tremor, it slipped from my hands and fell heavily and burst into pieces. And from it, with a rattling sound, there rolled out some instruments of dental surgery, intermingled with 32 small, white, and ivory-looking substances that were scattered to and fro about the floor. And that's the end of the story. I hope you've enjoyed listening to this. If you have any pointers for me,